I'd like to welcome everybody again to Midweek Bible Study on Thursday. Again, that's correct, I said Thursday. I'd like to thank you for tuning in and studying with us again this week as we continue to walk through the book of The Pursuit of God by A.W. Tozer. And before we get started, let's just open everybody up. Let's open up in prayer. Dear most graciously, Heavenly Father, we come to you today, Lord, just want to say thank you. Father, I pray, Heavenly Father, that as we dive into your word and study this book, Heavenly Father, we would just pray today, Lord, that you would continue to open our hearts and mind and continue to reveal yourself as force to us, Heavenly Father. And Lord, and I also pray, Heavenly Father, that as we've gone through the majority of this week, Heavenly Father, I pray for those that have tuned in and for those that are not, may not have tuned in, that for those that are going through trials and struggling this week, Heavenly Father, I pray that you would be with them and give them the peace that surpasses all understanding. And Lord, we also pray for our pastor, Heavenly Father, that you would be with him and continue to give him wisdom and insight and discernment as to lead the sheep that you have given him for this season. Lord, we thank you and we love you. These innumerable blessings we pray and ask for in your darling son's name, Jesus Christ. Amen and amen. Again, I'd like to thank everybody for joining us as for us today on Thursday for Midweek Bible Study as we continue to go through this book by A.W. Tozer. Last week, for those who joined us, went through chapter 3, which was taught by Reverend Callaghan, which talked about removing the veil. Well, this week, as we get ready to go through and dive into chapter 4, if you have your book with you, and if you've already read it, you probably should have a concept of what we're going to talk today about. But we're going to focus on the title, and I like the title of chapter 4, which states Apprehending God. And as I was reading this, this study, and I don't know if you got the same thing from it as well, a song came to my head about, yes, God is real. And the lyric goes a little something like this, as far as that, there are some things I may not know, there are some places I can't go, but I am sure of this one thing, that God is real, for I can feel in my soul. Yes, God is real, real in my soul. And some people here this morning, as far as understands that God is real, he called us out of darkness into the marvelous light, and we know that he's real because we can feel him in our soul. Tozer goes on in talking about apprehending God, and he goes to a verse in the book of Psalms 34 and 8, which states, taste and see that the Lord is good. Blessed is the one who takes refuge in him. And it says, taste and see that the Lord is good. Here David is forcing the word of taste. Taste is an imperative. It is a command. And basically what David is saying here is that those who trust in the Lord experience genuine happiness if they taste, find out, and see that the Lord is good. But as we get ready to dive into chapter 4, and we begin to look at the title, and it talks about apprehending God. And when one thinks about apprehending, are we talking about, are we arresting God, or what is Tozer by this catchy title he's using? In essence, what is he really trying to get to here? You know, what does apprehending God mean? Are we talking about to understand or to perceive God, to comprehend, to realize, to recognize, to appreciate, to discern, as far as God, to take hold of. Tozer states that to most people, when talking about apprehending God, he states that to most people, God is an inference and not a reality. Well, you know, reading this, what do we, what are we talking about here when he says that most people, God is an inference and not a reality? We're talking about taking hold. We're talking about trying to comprehend God, talking about apprehending God, to understand, to perceive. And basically what he's saying is that to most people, God is an inference, a conclusion or opinion that is formed because of known facts of evidence. And they see this, but that's what they see. Basically, we can look, when we talk about God and talk about the reality of God, talking about God being real. I mentioned a song and said the lyrics earlier for us that, yes, God is real. For my Bible studiers here, we understand that basically we could look at the world and the universe and say there must be a higher power, and we are okay with that, with saying that higher power of God. In the book of Romans 1:20, it states that for since the creation of the world, God's invisible qualities, his eternal power, and divine nature have been clearly seen, being understood from what has been made, so people are without excuse. In essence, what I just read, creation screams that there is a creator, and we know that creator to be Yahweh, God by himself. But we are still, as believers, we as people are still trying to apprehend God, understanding that God is real. We are still trying to understand, to comprehend, to grab hold on to God. Tozer states that people know of God only as hearsay. He states that people only know God as hearsay. Well, we've heard grandmama talk about him, and we've heard maybe an uncle talk about him, and maybe we was dragged into church. And it's you look in the book of Judges where you look at Gideon when he was approached, and he had heard about God, but ultimately he ended up having an experience as for us with God. He calls this that people have an objective knowledge of God, which means that I may know, I've come to Sunday school, or I've come to church, I know what people say about God, but from a subjective standpoint, we need to get a personal experience with God. We need to have, to truly know God, we have to have a personal relationship with him. We can't go on somebody else's credit. We, in order to truly to know him, we have to have a personalized, our own personal relationship with God himself. While admitting his existence, they do not think of him as knowable in a sense that we know things of people. Tozer goes on to say that people can know things that they've been taught about God, know things what other people have stated, but essence do not have a personal experience with God. Well, if we're talking about apprehending God, grabbing hold, perceive, understanding God, in Psalms 34, David says, taste and see. Basically, he's saying, find out and see for yourself that God is good. So how does one go about knowing God? To know God is to worship him and be transformed by him. Human knowledge of God, which begins with knowledge about him, comes through God's self-revelation. To know God is to worship God and to be transformed by him. I say that again. Human knowledge of God, which begins with knowledge about him, comes through a self-revelation. The nature of knowing God. To know God is not merely to know things about him and going back to having that personal experience with him, as far as that I can know stats about Walter Payton or Jerry Rice or Doug Williams or Patrick Mahomes or Randall Cunningham or Donovan McNabb, but I can know stats, I can know where they live, I can know maybe their favorite food just by picking up a book and reading these things, but I still don't have a personal relationship with them, even though I know these things about them. So to know God is not merely to know things about him, such as his character, but to also experience his presence and his power. And his power to know God is to be transformed about him. The origins of knowing God. I just listed a few things here, talking about this apprehending God that Tozer is talking about, and talking about this personal relationship, having a personal experience of God, that we as believers, that the mere facts of just knowing characteristics about God, there has to be a personal relationship to truly know. And as Reverend Caligon indicated last week about removing the veil from our hearts in order to have this personal relationship. But the origins of knowing God is for that God gives knowledge of his reality through creation. We talked about that earlier, that basically in Romans 1:20, that creation screams that there is a God. God gives knowledge of himself through Jesus Christ. God gives knowledge of himself and his ways through his Spirit in Ephesians 1:17. The nature of knowing God, to know Jesus Christ, is to know God. And John 14:6 states that I would ask the Father and he would give you another helper that he may be with you forever. The Holy Spirit is with you forever. So if you are truly born again, you do have, God has called you to him, you do have the Spirit in you. Millions of people go through life trying to love an idea and be loyal to a mere principle. I'm going to say that again. Tozer states that millions of people go through life trying to love an idea and be loyal to a mere principle. And they get that idea based upon what other people have told them, But God is more than a mere principle. He can be known in a personal experience. Again, God is real. And God wants a relationship with us. Tozer goes on and he states that we have our heart's organs by means of which we can know God as certainly as we know material things through our familiar five senses. But however, there has to be a saving work. In a life in sin, the sin nature in us wants us not to have anything to do with God. But God, in order to know God, God has to call you to him. And in seminary, when I was going through that, you heard these fancy words talking about an effective calling, a saving grace or saving faith. But there has to be an effective calling in words like regeneration and things of and those natures. But to know God, God has to call you to him. There has to be this fancy word call. An effective calling. And an effective calling is an act of God the Father speaking through human proclamation of the gospel in which he summons people, like a court order, like he summons people to himself in such a way that they respond and save in faith. The effective calling is an act of God. You no role in this. It's ultimately you by yourself on your own wouldn't come to God. God has to call you to him. And when God calls you to him, this is essence where you've been trained. We've heard of this word talked about regeneration, and regeneration is an act of God in which he imparts new spiritual life to us. This is called being born again. In Ezekiel 36, 26 and 27, God states a new heart, I will give you and a new spirit I will put within you, and I will take out of you your flesh of stone and give you a heart of flesh, a heart of flesh, and I will put my spirit within you and cause you to walk in my statutes and be careful to observe my ordinance. Now we're talking about apprehending God, seizing God, understanding God. In order to have a personal relationship with God, God has to call you to him. Tozer states that the saving work must first be done in the heart is taken for granted here. The spiritual faculties of the unregenerate man lie asleep in his nature and for every purpose dead. However, they must be moved to active life again by the operation of the Holy Spirit and regeneration. So the question comes from, but for the very ransomed children of God themselves, why do they know so little of the conscious communion with God, with the scriptures, seems to offer? Now, let's think about this. Talking about having a personal relationship, knowing things. Who in here has a kid, or say if you have taken another step and gone out and have adopted a kid, that you go, don't know, kid don't know you, you adopt, bring into your family, but yet want to set aside and don't want to have a personal relationship with them? Who has a kid, carries a kid 9 months and gives birth to a kid, but yet just wants to set the kid aside and not want to have a personal relationship with? Who? No one. We can't fathom that. So for those that we consider family, for those that we've brought in, for those that we even consider close friends, we're all about relationships. We want to have a personal relationship. So this concept of apprehending God, taking hold, seizing, understanding, to say that God does not want to have a personal relationship with you is ludicrous. God wants to have a personal relationship with you. He wouldn't have called you out of darkness into the marvelous light if he did not want to have a personal relationship with you. But some people sometimes, Christians, tend to not maximize that relationship of that walk or the benefits that they get from God with that personal relationship. And Tozer goes on to state that the reason that most people don't maximize the benefit by having this personal relationship with God, and we're talking about Christians here, is because there is a chronic unbelief. Sometimes, you know, we understand things that are real. This podium is real. I can touch it. I can feel it. I can see it. And if there was something on it, I could smell it. It is real. If I leave here today and come back tomorrow, I still know that this is real because of my five senses. I know this to be real. And even though that God is still spirit, and even though I can't see him, even though I can't smell him, even though literally I can't hold the hand and feel, God is still very much still as real as this podium here that I am teaching from today. But talking about this chronic unbelief, we should all, when it comes to unbelief, we should all be like the father of the boy that was possessed in Mark chapter 9 and verse 24, when he screamed out, when he exclaimed to Jesus, when he said, "Jesus, help me overcome my unbelief." And maybe that's what somebody here today, even me, because I worry about a whole lot of things I shouldn't be worried about, that if I truly say I'm giving it over to God, then I'm giving it over to God. But somebody here today that may be watching, or maybe you tell a friend this afternoon is for us, that we should be screaming to God, "God, help me overcome my unbelief." But therefore, our lack of faith appears to be a major hindrance of us with this personal relationship with Christ. Tozer states that faith enables our spiritual sense to function. But he also says that where faith is defective, the results will be inward insensibility and numbness towards spiritual things. He states that this is the condition of a vast number of Christians today. The reason a lot of them, and I agree with him, the reason a lot of us don't have the relationship with Christ, with God, that we should have, is because our faith is defective. Due to the fact that God is spirit, that we can't touch, we can't see, that we tend to, maybe our faith becomes a little defective. And therefore, our walk and our experience with God isn't what it should be. And most definitely, it isn't what it most definitely it could be and what God intends for it to be. Because he wants to have relationship with us. God himself is here waiting for our response to his presence. The eternal world will come alive to us the moment we begin to reckon upon its reality. Tozer states that which is real has a being in itself. It doesn't depend upon the observer for its validity. What's real? I don't need to be able to see it. I don't need an observer to see it for it to be valid. And we have none other to go over to John chapter 20 and 29 when that's going with John chapter 20, 29, that we tend to see things that are real that I can see, I can touch, I can feel, I can smell, I can taste, is a reality to people. But Jesus said to him, talking to Thomas, "Because you see me, you have believed. But blessed are those who haven't seen and have believed." Tozer goes on to say that we think of the visible world as real and doubt the reality of any other. We do not deny the existence of the spiritual world, but we doubt that it is real in the accepted meaning of the word. As I get ready to close, and I indicate again, when we're talking about apprehending God, touching God, understanding God, perceiving God, grabbing hold on to God, understanding that if we have faith of a mustard seed, we can tell this mountain to move, and it will move, that understanding that God is very much real. God is spirit and is very real. As we begin to focus upon God, the things of the spirit will take shape before our inner eyes. Obedience to the word of Christ will bring an inward revelation of the Godhead. It will give acute perception, enabling us to see God even as is promised to the pure heart. As I get ready to leave, and as you thank you for joining us this week, but as I closed in chapter 4 of Apprehending God of Tozer, is for is that the one thing that jumps out is that for everybody should understand that God is real. And the reason I know that he's real and know that he lives because he lives within inside of me. Grab hold to the God, to the Father, who's called you out of darkness and into the marvelous light. God did not call you out of darkness into the marvelous light to set you to the side and not want to have intimate, personal relationship with you. Remember that in apprehending your Father, Yahweh, God, wants to have a personal relationship with you. And he is as real as the shirt I have on, the glasses that are on my eyes, the watch that's on my wrist, and this stand that I'm teaching from. Yes, God is real. Take advantage of the relationship that the Father wants with you. Dear most graciously Heavenly Father, we come to you today, Lord. Just want to say thank you. Lord, we thank you for calling us out of darkness into the marvelous light. We thank you for being real. We thank you for living within inside of us. And somebody here this morning, this evening, Heavenly Father, is dealing with some struggles, Heavenly Father. Somebody is having some issues, and maybe our prayer should be that as in Mark 9, Heavenly Father, that if our lack of faith, if our defective faith is hindering our relationship with you, Heavenly Father, I'll scream for them as I'm screaming for myself. Lord, I ask that you help me with my unbelief. And Lord, but I ask that you pray over everyone who's watching today, pray over this church as we go throughout the rest of this week. These are minimal blessings we pray and ask for your darling son's name, Jesus Christ. Amen and amen.